Christian Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Spiritual House Cleaning, Protect Your Home and Family from Spiritual Pollution by Eddie Smith and Alice Smith. Narrated by Al Kessel. Preface. Fasten your seatbelt. In the 1980s, I, Eddie, took a church pastoral staff job, and we bought a house and settled down. Alice became an award-winning real estate agent. During the next 11 years, we served a local congregation in Houston, Texas. It wasn't long before we encountered experiences with the demonic among our membership, and then other churches began to send us people who needed counseling involving the supernatural, demons, and the rest. One night, we facilitated the deliverance of a dear lady in Northwest Houston. To make an extremely long story short, we and another pastor from our church were challenging the demons that were tormenting the lady when we asked, "What gives you the right to stay in her?" With that, the lady's arm involuntarily moved above her head and pointed to a bookshelf with a sliding door. We opened the door and discovered a Christian book about demons. "This?" we asked. The lady's face twisted into a sarcastic sneer, and the demon, speaking through her, said devilishly, "Yes." Without a thought, I ripped the book into shreds. As I did, the demon shrieked and left her. She was freed. Our pastoral team learned to minister to people using ministry teams of 3 to 5 people. Soon, we developed a system we called ministry team training to teach our church members how to minister in teams. Before long, hundreds of people from churches across the South came to our church to be trained at our quarterly training events. The course further developed as the experience of our team grew, and we established multiple levels of training. Shortly after leaving the church to do the work we now do, writing and teaching at conferences around the world, we wrote the original edition of Spiritual House Cleaning. To our amazement, and perhaps our publishers, our book became an overnight bestseller. People from various nations, cultures, and languages sent us praise reports. They'd read our book, had applied the biblical principles we presented, and had found victory. In this revised and updated edition of Spiritual House Cleaning, we share some of their stories with you. Why? To help you see even more clearly why living a life of purity and victory depends on our forsaking things that dishonor Christ and His kingdom, and to help you understand that evil has the same mode of operation wherever it exists around the world. Evil is neither creative nor complex. In fact, it's quite predictable. So, fasten your seatbelt. Some of the stories you will hear will amaze you. But we aren't the least bit interested in your entertainment. Rather, we pray that you'll receive new revelation of the tactics of the enemy so that you can live free and set others free. Scripture clearly teaches that evil will become darker and righteousness brighter until our Lord comes for His church. Isaiah chapter 60 verses 1 through 3, Daniel chapter 12 verse 3, Matthew chapter 13 verses 24 through 43, 2 Timothy chapter 3 verse 13. Let's prepare. The worst and the best are yet to come. Eddie and Alice, Houston, Texas. Introduction. Why we wrote this book. Imagine there was a plague of snakes of biblical proportion in your city. The house in which you live became completely overrun with deadly, poisonous snakes. How important would it be for you to make sure some of the snakes were removed? You would not even consider that an option, would you? Absolutely not. You would insist that all of the snakes be removed if you and your family were to continue to live there. Could you sleep peacefully if you thought there might be even one poisonous snake left in your home? Hardly. Would you believe there could be possessions inside your home right now that pose a spiritual threat to you and your family, just like poisonous snakes pose a physical threat? The average Christian family may not even be aware of the necessity to spiritually clean their house in order to experience the peaceful presence of God. That's why we wrote this book. Many of us are suffering today because we have sometimes willfully and sometimes ignorantly invited possessions and behaviors into our homes that defile the atmosphere and give the devil the right to affect our lives and the lives of our children. This defilement can come in many forms: statues of foreign gods, magic charms, occult books, or perverse souvenirs of past sins. But whatever the form, God doesn't want us to possess defiled objects, for they invite the devil to wreak havoc with our hearts and homes. That is clearly not how Christ wants us to live. Paul tells us in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 20, "I do not want you to have fellowship with demons." To the uninitiated listener, some of what's contained in this book may sound a bit like superstition. We understand where you are coming from. Some might even conclude that our belief in a spirit world and faith in an unseen God is a superstition. But to us, superstition is placing faith in any person, place, or thing other than the Almighty God and His infallible Word. We reveal not legalism or superstition, but biblical principles and proven practices that can indeed free us and our households from any spiritual bondage. That being said, Christ's cross and resurrection have established our authority over the devil. Since Jesus gives us His authority, we are to live on the offensive. Matthew chapter 10, verse 1, Luke chapter 19, verse 10, Ephesians chapter 6, verse 10. For that reason, we should never fear the devil or demons. Jesus set the example for us when He taught us to pray, "Deliver us from evil." Matthew chapter 6, verse 13, King James Version. The Lord's deliverance is available to those who walk in the way of righteousness. With this knowledge, as children of the King, we exchange our fear for freedom. Yet, to fully live in our inheritance, we must be sure there is nothing in our lives or in our homes that would hinder our fellowship with God. What does purity of heart involve for us as Christians? What does it mean to love God with all our hearts, our souls, and our minds? It means to not allow Satan access to any aspect of our lives, thereby keeping ourselves undefiled. It means that we don't give Satan any place or allow him any opportunity. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 27. Today is a new day for the church. It's time for the Church of Jesus Christ to awaken from her slumber. We can no longer afford to wallow in the carnality of the world and expect the Lord to overlook it. Today, God is calling us to a new level of holiness. We need to cleanse the atmosphere of our homes as well as our hearts. This cleansing often involves the removal of certain physical possessions. But which ones? We have written this book to teach you how to walk circumspectly and to exercise spiritual discernment. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 15. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 15. This may very well prove to be one of the most important books you will ever listen to, because its principles can provide the key to spiritual peace and security for you and your entire family. We have a world to reach with the gospel. But before we can reach a fallen world, God must reach us. Our lives and our possessions should reflect God's kingdom rule. We're not to live under the tyranny of legalism or performance. We are to be godly and grateful because we know we owe everything to our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Part 1. Spiritual Housecleaning Principles. 1. Spiritual Discernment. The Indian sun blazed, raising temperatures to 118 degrees Fahrenheit by midday. People were dying due to the excessive heat. To protect themselves, most would work until about 10 a.m., retreat inside until sundown, and then resume their business and shopping. Robert, our eldest son, and I, Eddie, were in Kharagpur, India, to teach at a Christian conference, and by the grace of God, we managed to survive the heat. More than 300 Indian Christians joined us there, bearing the intense heat as they rode bicycles, buses, and trains, some for days, to attend the conference. Once there, they slept on concrete floors, bathed out of buckets, and ate food cooked over outdoor fires. We taught various subjects, but my teaching on spiritual housecleaning had the most far-reaching impact on this idol-worshipping culture. As I spoke about unbiblical heathen practices and cultural traditions, I could see my listeners removing from their bodies, their pockets, and their purses the Hindu fetishes, that is, string bracelets, necklaces, and charms they wore or carried in hopes that a particular god would protect or provide for them. I gave the altar call. With zeal, they brought those forbidden, spiritually defiled items to the altar and discarded them. Acts chapter 19, verses 18 through 19. Freedom rang out like church bells in the hearts of those precious people that day. Curses were broken, generational sin was severed, and spiritual liberty was released. Some people were healed, and others were saved. The next day, we baptized 67 in a public city pond. Robert and I left the hotel the day after our conference to catch our plane for the United States. We'd been gone from the hotel for about 30 minutes when we received a phone call telling us that the police had come to the hotel to arrest us, just minutes after we left. God spared us the trouble. Why did they want to arrest us? Was it because 67 people had trusted Christ? Was it because 67 people had renounced their Hindu faith and been baptized? No. It was because we had taught them that their Hindu worship artifacts were evil, defiled, and forbidden by God. The newspapers reported that we had offended and belittled their Hindu gods and that we'd converted 300 of their people. They didn't understand a thing about the true conversion of the 67 who'd received eternal life, but instead focused on the 300 who disposed of their fetishes. Wouldn't you agree that if asking people to divest themselves of these things offended the Hindu priest so much that they sent the police to arrest us, it's safe to assume that those things, or rather the Hindu gods behind them, held some sort of power over them? And for us to possess such things glorifies devils and grieves the one true God. Acts chapters 24 through 29, 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 18 through 22. Genesis chapter 35, verses 1 through 5, gives us a biblical example of this truth. And God said unto Jacob, Arise, go up to Bethel, and dwell there, and make there an altar unto God, that appeared unto thee when thou fleddest from the face of Esau thy brother. Then Jacob said unto his household, and to all that were with him, Put away the strange gods that are among you, and be clean, and change your garments. And let us arise, and go up to Bethel. And I will make there an altar unto God, who answered me in the day of my distress, and was with me in the way which I went. And they gave unto Jacob all the strange gods which were in their hand, and all their earrings which were in their ears. And Jacob hid them under the yoke which was by Shechem. And they journeyed, and the terror of God was upon the cities that were round about them, and they did not pursue after the sons of Jacob. King James Version. After Jacob and his family got rid of their objects of idolatry, God honored them. His presence went with them and put terror in the hearts of the people around them, people who might otherwise have attacked them. Today, the same power and favor of God is available to us, whether we are in India, America, Antarctica, or anywhere else in the world. Time and again, for over 40 years, our experiences with spiritual house cleaning have shown this to be true. Encounters with demons. In our early days of itinerant evangelism, we traveled hundreds of thousands of miles, living in a motorhome that we lovingly called our piece of wheel estate. In fact, during that time, we owned 7 such vehicles before we stopped traveling. We conducted hundreds of evangelistic crusades in churches and football stadiums across America. We were blessed to see thousands of people come to Christ. During those early years of our ministry, we did a great deal of personal counseling. Traveling as we did from town to town, we began to recognize spiritual patterns. Regardless of whether we were in a city, in suburbs, or in small rural towns, we noticed similar things happening in the spiritual realm. In the late 60s and early 70s, few books had been written about spiritual warfare or deliverance. Pigs in the Parlor, written by our friend, the late Frank Hammond, was one of the first. Hollywood's burgeoning fascination with the demonic expressed itself in films like Rosemary's Baby, Poltergeist, and The Exorcist, to name a few. Added to that was the massive influx of immigrants to the United States who arrived with their family gods and religious cultural practices, many ready to build their temples and mosques right in our neighborhoods. Our land quickly became defiled. Don't misunderstand, America has her own demons. But our Leave It to Beaver days were over, and demonic manifestations began to explode in this nation through the media and through the collapse of moral integrity in our courts. We encountered our first case of a demonized person in a large Baptist church in South Texas. Frankly, we were stunned to witness a respected church-going woman lying on the floor of her pastor's office, hissing and writhing like a snake, speaking with an unearthly male-sounding voice. From that moment, we were completely convinced that Satan is more than an evil idea or philosophy. He and his minions are real spiritual beings, like people without bodies, who have an intense desire to inhabit human bodies to fulfill their lusts and desires and advance Satan's kingdom. Matthew chapter 12, verses 25 through 26, and verses 43 through 45. Soon, we were routinely counseling demonized people, leading them through deliverance from the demons that plagued them, many from birth. At the same time, we encountered people, godly people, believable people, who were experiencing poltergeists, mischievous demons who move objects, ghosts, demons masquerading as the deceased, and other troubling manifestations. Children were the most easily harassed by them. They suffered from insomnia, nightmares, and more. To learn more about deliverance, see Alice Smith, Delivering the Captives. As our experience grew, so did our understanding. We discovered that the demons that plagued people were in some cases strengthened by unholy possessions, defiled, forbidden objects that dishonored Christ, Deuteronomy chapter 7, verses 25 through 26, Hosea chapter 4, verses 10 through 13, 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 18 through 22. Almost weekly, we saw people who, as they discarded these possessions, experienced freedom from demonic manifestations. In Acts chapter 19, we see how Ephesian believers destroyed their occult material when they saw the power of God at work through Paul. In that day, Ephesus was known as a witchcraft capital of the Roman world. It was a city famed for its written collections of occult spells, statues and images of the goddess Diana, and for the practitioners who used them. Paul shook up the city when he came preaching the name of Jesus in the power of the Holy Spirit. Through signs, wonders, and deliverances, many believed. But it took a demonic attack of the 7 sons of Sceva to show the Ephesian Christians that they needed to shut every door to evil activity in their lives, Acts chapter 19, verses 11 through 16. When this happened, those believers got the message, Jesus is the highest power in the universe. They then burned their books of the occult, rid themselves of idolatry, and confessed their sins publicly. What happened next? The word of the Lord grew mightily and prevailed. Acts chapter 19, verse 20. Ministering deliverance. During a conference in a southern state, there was a gathering at the pastor's home. One of the ladies in the group caught our attention. We both discerned a spiritual defilement about her. Jane, not her real name, was the music minister's wife, and her husband was out of town that week. Before the week was over, we found ourselves counseling with her concerning her sexual involvement with one of the teenage boys in the church. Yes, she was sexually active with one of the church's own teens. We asked Jane about her salvation. This pretty young woman said she had been saved one night while driving her truck. A voice had whispered in her left ear, "Give me your life." And she said, "Lord, I do give you my life." "And to whom were you speaking?" we probed. "What do you mean, to whom?" she said. "I was speaking to God." "How did you know it was God?" "You mean it might have been a demonic spirit?" She realized that from the moment she'd made that commitment, her life had begun a downhill slide. If you ask God for a fish, he won't give you a serpent, but a devil certainly may. In Matthew chapter 7, verses 17 through 20, Jesus said that the fruits, people's actions and character, show whether the source of that fruit is good and from God, or bad and not from God. This woman's decision produced the bad fruit of growing oppression and uncontrollable sin in her life, which showed that she had unwittingly given her life to demons. The bottom line? She was born again and delivered that week. All the issues came out for the necessary parties to bring correction. 2 weeks later, her husband called to tell us she was suffering from an overwhelming temptation to rekindle her sinful relationship with the boy. Through phone counseling, we discovered that she had a blouse and a necklace the young man had given her. Those gifts, we explained, were physical representations of their sin. Covenants are sealed with gifts. They strengthen the soul tie, a spiritual attachment between people brought about through evil actions or unholy covenants between them. It wasn't until she destroyed the items that she was set free. People can develop godly soul ties like Jonathan and David, 1 Samuel chapter 18, verse 1, or ungodly soul ties like Samson and Delilah, Judges chapter 16, verses 4 through 19. Because we were traveling evangelists, we had far more experiences and encounters than we would have had were we pastors in one locale. One night in a tiny Tennessee church, we were in a pastor's study trying to help Kim, a delinquent teenage girl. When Kim's unwed teenage mother conceived her, her mother and father, Kim's grandparents, out of shame, tried to cover their daughter's sin. They sent her away until she gave birth to Kim. During that time, the family moved to another city and didn't tell extended family members about the pregnancy or the birth. When Kim was born, her grandparents adopted her and never disclosed to her that she was actually their granddaughter, not their daughter. Kim was taught and believed that her birth mother was her older sister. One day, one of Kim's cousins discovered the deception and told her about it. Her parents, actually her grandparents, lied again and told her it was only a cruel prank. She believed her cousin and became depressed, suspicious, and severely troubled. She didn't know who or what to believe. Kim's mother and father, again actually her grandparents, brought her to us for counseling. When they told us how they had lied to her, we insisted that they tell Kim the awful truth, no matter how painful it would be. Kim could never build a healthy life on a foundation of lies and deceit. That night, they disclosed to Kim that she was their granddaughter and that her sister was actually her mother. She was devastated, but in her heart she had known all along that something wasn't right. Kim had lived with a lie her entire life, and it affected her core identity. For an hour, we ministered deliverance to Kim without seeing the breakthrough we'd hoped for. We were stymied. It seemed we'd hit the proverbial brick wall. We prayed for God to reveal why we were so impotent against the spirits that bound her. Then, we noticed something in a lower bookshelf. The pastor's bottom bookshelf contained a copy of Anton Levy's Satanic Bible, along with several other occult handbooks. We asked the pastor why he had them. He said he had bought them for research. We explained to him that they were compromising the young lady's deliverance. We stopped our session, took the books outside to a trash-burning bin, and set fire to them. It was almost impossible to get them lit, but after we did, the most amazing thing happened. Since then, we've seen this many times and hear about it often. No matter which side of the bin we chose to stand on, regardless of the direction of the slight breeze that night, the flames licked out at us. When we moved away from the bin, they licked farther, trying to reach us. It was almost as if the flames had minds of their own. Once the books were destroyed, Kim was completely liberated by the Lord. Spiritual defilement in the home. The woman's voice on the other end of the line sounded eerie and mystical. She had sought help from a Christian psychiatric hospital that had referred her to us. This divorced woman and her 8-year-old daughter lived alone, trapped in a world of darkness. The girl's father was a Unitarian pastor, but prior to that, he had been an African witch doctor in a tribe known as the Leopard People. The now abandoned single mom had extensive knowledge of the occult, and though she testified to having been recently born again, within the walls of her home, torment ruled. At her request, we visited her home. Cats fearfully scurried from under our feet as our small prayer team approached the apartment door. When the woman opened the door, we were introduced to an atmosphere that almost took our breath away. It felt electric with evil. Once inside, two large cats cowering near the refrigerator hissed at us, then disappeared within seconds. The electrical power flashed on and off until we commanded it to stop. To the right of the front door was a 10-foot bookcase filled with religious, heathen, and occult books. She invited us to be seated, and we began to discuss her problems. She explained that her daughter was being harassed in the night by nightmares and apparitions. The child would awake to see ghosts in her room. The ghosts were actually demons appearing in the forms of an old African Aboriginal man and woman. The concerned mother stated that at times the child would leap on top of the dressers and move about like a leopard. This precious little girl would sometimes awake in the morning with human-like bite marks and claw scratches in the middle of her back. One night, the frightened girl awakened her mother several times, complaining that flies were biting her. Each time, her mother turned on the lights and searched the room, but found nothing. The next morning, when she opened the window shades, she found a mound of dead flies piled on her daughter's windowsill. This didn't surprise us. We know that Satan is referred to as Beelzebub, the Lord of Flies, Matthew chapter 12, verses 24 through 32, Mark chapter 3, verse 22. The enemy had clearly been given authority to operate in their home. As we prayed and asked God for wisdom and discernment, we waited for the Holy Spirit's direction. The demonic reality was almost palpable. Spiritual impressions from the Lord, that is, the word of knowledge, 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 8, came to our team members as we cleansed the atmosphere with prayer. All at once, as though the team had received the same revelation, we turned and stared at the wall of books, her huge occult library. We explained to the young mother that the books and the artwork acted as bait for the demons. As flies are attracted to dung, demons are attracted to darkness. Her library was an open invitation to demonic spirits and gave them legal right to defile her home and harass her child. These books, like a welcome mat, communicated to the unseen demonic world that they had the woman's permission to stay. Such items and artifacts may seem harmless, yet they hold significance to satanic spirits. We urged the mother to discard the occult books. We even offered to dispose of them for her. She refused. She lamented over the money she'd invested in the books. We lovingly explained that the books symbolized contracts she'd made with the enemy, and unless she forsook them, we'd have no authority over the demons that victimized them. We begged for the sake of her daughter that she spiritually clean the house, but she turned a deaf ear to us. This woman's attachment to her occult library compromised her and her daughter's spiritual security and allowed the enemy to terrorize her child. Sadly, we were unable to go any further. See Peter Wagner shares an account of the power of idols in the ancient city of Athens. The only place in the Bible where we find the phrase given over to idols, from the Greek katidelos, is where Luke describes Athens in Acts chapter 17, verse 16. Athens was the idol capital of the ancient world, possibly comparable to Kyoto, Japan today. The literature of that day describes Athens as a forest of idols in which it is easier to find a god than a human being. Certain streets had so many idols that pedestrian traffic was difficult. One observer estimated that Athens contained more idols than the rest of Greece combined. Because idols themselves are only made of wood or stone or metal, some are not concerned about their presence. These idols, however, were not just any piece of wood or stone or metal. They had been carefully and intentionally crafted by human beings as forms in the visible world through which the forces of the invisible world of darkness were invited to control the lives of people, families, and the city as a whole, locking the people in spiritual darkness. That's why we read that Paul's spirit was provoked within him. Verse 16. Yet, this is not the only illustration of defilement. Let's analyze what happened to Joshua in the Old Testament. A piece of cake? The following is a loose adaptation of Joshua chapter 7. General Eliasaph is a character created for the sake of readability. "Now, sir, let's not overreact," suggested Eliasaph, General Joshua's senior military advisor. "We can relax now and give the men a break. Trust me, this one is going to be a piece of cake. According to our reconnaissance, there's no reason at all for you to send the entire Israeli army to attack such a small place as Ai." Ai literally means a heap of ruin. "I suggest that a reduced force of 2,000 or 3,000 troops will be sufficient to utterly destroy the city." So the next morning, Joshua sent 3,000 troops to annihilate little Ai. To their surprise, the feisty troops of Ai, ready for battle, killed 36 Israeli soldiers and chased the others from the gate of the city down the slope to the stone quarries. Israel's dispirited army was forced to retreat like a dog with its tail tucked between its legs. Joshua was stunned when he heard the news. After all, the much larger city of Jericho, which they'd soundly defeated, still lay in smoldering ruins. How could Eliasaph have so grossly underestimated the military capability of a small town like Ai? Joshua wondered. More important, where was God? And what about the promises he had made to them? God had clearly said, "Joshua, I'm giving to you the land I promised Moses. I will always be with you, and I will help you as I helped him. No one will ever be able to defeat you. So be strong and courageous. Do everything Moses taught you. Never stop reading the book of law he gave you. Think about what it says day and night. Obey it completely, and you will be able to take this land. See Joshua chapter 1, verses 1 through 9. Joshua called together an emergency council meeting of Israel's leaders. "Gentlemen," he said, "you will recall that Jehovah God promised us that He would never leave us and that we would never be defeated. Where do you suppose we went wrong when that handful of untrained ragtag men disgraced our troops today? May I suggest, sirs, that we have a national emergency on our hands, and we must get to the bottom of this now." So Joshua and the leaders tore their clothes and put dirt on their heads as a symbol of sorrow and repentance. They lay face down on the ground in front of the Ark of the Covenant and cried out to God until sunset. Then Joshua prayed, "Lord, did you bring us across the Jordan just so the Amorites could annihilate us? If we had stayed on the other side of the Jordan, none of this would have happened. Frankly, I'm speechless. It's shocking to realize that our army actually ran from our enemy today. Our people will soon think that you can no longer protect us. When our enemies hear of our humiliation, they are likely to become emboldened. They may even try to surround us and wipe us out." The Lord answered Joshua, "General, get up off your face. I'm not taking prayer requests at this time. I told you that everything in Jericho belonged to me. What's more, I told you to destroy the city and everything in it. Instead, you and your people have stolen and hidden some of the booty for yourselves, and you've lied about it. Because you've stolen stuff that was to be destroyed, Israel itself has been set aside for destruction. I can't help you anymore until you do exactly what I've told you to do. And that's precisely why your army could not stand before the little band of men at Ai. Tell the people that they'll never be able to stand against another enemy until they rid themselves of the abominable things that they've hidden. Tell them to prepare for worship. Tomorrow morning, when they gather for worship, I will identify for you the guilty tribe and point out the guilty clan and the guilty family. And I will show you the man who stole the forbidden things that have defiled Israel and have broken the sacred covenant I made with you. That man, along with his wife, his sons, and his daughters, must be executed by stoning. Their bodies and all of their possessions must be burned." Early the next morning, Joshua...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.